Hello and welcome to the sort of second part of the Sandy text tutorial. And you might be wondering why on earth do we need a second part with this? And that's because I felt like I was retreading old ground with the previous part, and a lot of that information could have been found in other people's tutorials or even in my own. That's why we're going to use the previous effect and convert it to a real 3D text. And while doing that, we're going to encounter a lot of different problems that we're going to fix, hopefully encouraging you to try out new stuff on your own, to learn how to problem solve in Fusion and also interact with a lot of different parts. Okay, so let's start. First of all, I'm going to decrease the number of particles again, simply because I want to render this quickly while we're working interactively. And let's add in a text 3D. Okay, first of all, we obviously want the same text as we have in our text 2D. Okay, I've simply created a text 3D and I've changed the text to the same text as we have in our text plus, and I changed the font to the same font. Next, let's look at this with our particles and see if this is all we need to do. And no, of course not. And this is because our text is much bigger than our 2D text. Well, Fusion uses a relative coordinate system. This is something you might have learned already from my tutorials. And let's see if we can spot the difference. I'm going to pin this to my inspector and I'm going to look at the text plus. They use almost the same user interface. The difference is the size. We have right here our size is 0.2 and right here our size is 1. Now we have the same size, but it's a little bit off. And this is because our V anchor actually needs to be at 0 and not at the bottom. And now they are overlaying perfectly. So we can get rid of our text 2D. And now let's give this a little bit of depth, because this is after all the reason why we're using a text 3D. And let's activate the particles again. And looking at this, and whoa, now our particles are spawning inside of our text. That makes sense, of course, because our text is extruding in the front. We could either manually move this back until our particles are in front, or we could use an expression in our transform tab to automatically move this back as far as we need to. So let's do just that. I'm going to hit expression. I'm going to take the pick whip. We want to move our 3D text in Z by the same amount that our extrusion depth is. So let's choose this. And first of all, it's going forwards, of course. So let's add in a minus. But this doesn't seem right, because now it's much further back. And this is because if we decrease, no, actually I'm just going to increase the extrusion depth. Yeah, here you can see it much better now. It's moving much further backwards, even though the extrusion depth isn't so high. And this is because the extrusion depth is actually relative to the size. This will only be 0.1 long if I set the size to 1. Because now if I change this, now the front of our text 3D is always staying on the center. So, and this is what I mean with problem solving. Let's change this back to 0.2. All we need to do is multiply our extrusion depth in our Z by the size. Oh, and make sure this is written correctly. And now we can change the extrusion depth and it will always stay at 0 point. Okay, next problem. The text is visible and we don't have a mask input. We only have a scene input. We don't even have a material input right here. So we can't even plug in a material that has a varying degree of opacity. But we can use a replace material 3D to replace our text. So let's plug in our color mask. Now it's being shaded. But of course, we don't actually have any alpha animation right here in our background. We need to use another matte control and plug in our original rectangle. And again, set this to combine alpha, post multiply. Let's look at our alpha values. They're correct. Let's look back at our text and oh, this isn't looking good. And this is because the material will be put on each character individually. So let's fix that problem by adding in a UVMap 3D. Keep it on planar, but change the orientation to Z. And now our text is properly appearing. Now let's look at the animation again. Still not working. And the reason for that is our UVMap is now projecting our 16:9 ratio image onto a square rectangle. And 16:9 has an aspect ratio of 1:1.778. So let's change that. 1.778 to 1 in Y. But looking at this, the distance is definitely off. And this is something I've touched at in the portal tutorial where I'm explaining a little bit of the Bcustom tool. The coordinate system right here starts at 0 and ends at 1. While in 3D, we always start at 0 and we go into minus and we go into plus. So this actually needs to be divided by 2. And now the distance between our edges is the same as in our 2D image. Now let's add in another merge 3D so we can double check and add in our image plane 3D right here for our 2D text. And it's working correctly. Quick note from editing, while recording I've mistakenly added a time stretcher right here, so you can just ignore that. We have a 3D text and we have our particles. Let's render this. Oof, that doesn't look good. And one of the reasons we would go into a 3D is obviously because we want to have some light interaction. So let's activate lighting. And we don't see anything because we don't have any lights in there. So I'm just going to add in a spotlight because that's one of the few lights that supports shadows. If you're using 17:1, you also have shadows on the directional light and can use the directional light as well. I'm still on 17 because 17:1 has a lot of bugs. So I'm just quickly going to place the light. So I've placed the spotlight. And this is what we have right now. And if this is all you want, then great. But of course, I want to show you something else to solve even more problems. Because if we're in 3D, we might also want to use an actual 3D shader. So let's take a blend, for example. On our blend, decrease the exponent so we actually see the specular. Okay, and let's render this. And now we see another problem. Our text is already visible, even though the alpha is 0. And I can show you that the alpha is 0 if I click on the renderer 3D. If I'm going to activate the alpha channel, all the alpha values are 0, where the alpha values are 0 on our mask. And yet we still see the specular. And of course, we can fix that. If the specular isn't being multiplied by the alpha by default, we simply do it ourselves by using an alpha multiply. And ta-da! Now this is gone. But the alpha of our particles and the alpha of our text was already multiplied, which means that if we're doing this twice, pretty much all of our particles are now invisible because this is eating a little bit into the edges and the particles are very small to begin with. And if we look very closely and on the edges of our text, we can also see that they are being eaten away a little bit. We can't fix this problem completely, but the edges on our text aren't really the issue. We can live with a few pixels less on the edges right here, but we do need our particles. So what we need to do is separate our particles and render them individually. So let's do that. Let's cut out the text. Let's remove the alpha multiply for now. Our particles are back. And now let's merge in the text. First we need another merge 3D. So we can add in our spotlight and our camera again. And now another renderer 3D. And there's our text. Let's add this on top. Just like before in 3D, but this time on 2D, our particles are being hidden by the text. We could change this by pressing Ctrl T to swap the inputs. Now all the particles are in front, and the particles that are behind the geometry or in the geometry would still be visible. So we need to cut out the area in 3D. And to do that, I'm going to take the text right here. I'm going to plug that back in to our particle render, and I'm going to choose an override 3D. And in this override 3D, I'm going to set the mat to do mat, is mat, and now our text will cut out our particles. If we hit opaque alpha, we can actually see the text is still here, but without this, this will remove the particles that are behind or inside of our geometry. I'm going to toggle the visibility. So this is with our mat and this is without. So the particles that are inside or behind the text right now, those will be cut out. So now we have our particles and we have our text. And now we can multiply the alpha again to get rid of the specular. And we need to take the vector motion blur and we need to add it to both our renderer 3Ds. Otherwise, we would only have motion blur on the background input, which would be the text. Quick edit, because I did encounter a problem that I didn't before and I had to fix it. I'm quickly going to show you what I changed. And the issue was the motion blur, because I wanted to, or I did add two motion blurs after each render 3D, because obviously I want to have motion blur on our text. And I also want motion blur on our particles. But when I was adding this vector motion blur, I realized Fusion was getting very, very slow. And I realized our text mat is still generating motion vectors. And even worse, we have a few values in here, which are ridiculously high, which cause Fusion to crash and hang and smear motion blur all over the place. We could have normalized the motion vectors like we did in the portal tutorial, but I've actually chosen something simpler for this scene, which is I've simply taken our particles and I've merged them with our camera and only rendered the particles. We also don't need lighting or anything for this. We only need the vectors. And then I took and copy aux to map the auxiliary channel to our colors. And I've used that as the input for our vector motion blur and changed X and Y channel to red and green, so it doesn't read in the vector pass that's being generated here. We can actually stop rendering this. And now we're just going to let this render a little bit and then I'll be back and tell you what I did for the finishing touches. But this is pretty much the whole tutorial. Now you know how to solve a few problems in Fusion 3D space. If you've watched till now, then I applaud you. And now you know a lot about very different niche tools and niche settings in Fusion. But I hope that I could show you that if you see a problem in Fusion, there is almost always a way to fix it. Maybe you have to jump through a few hoops, but it's going to work. Okay, so we're back. And this is the rendered result. This took actually quite some time because the amount of particles is just very, very huge. This is the particle branch right here. And first I brightened that up a little bit and I decreased gamma to increase the contrast a little bit. And then I've merged that with my text, and on the text all I did was add the highlight tool. I usually like to change the number of points to 2 because this gives these very nice streaks, and I don't really like these stars. There has to be a good reason why I choose the stars. After I merged that, I've added a soft glow, and next I've taken the text again, blurred it only in the X direction, which gives this nice streaky blur. You could have used a directional blur as well, but this time I've chosen a simple blur, given that some glow as well, and merged that on top. And here I've set alpha gain to 0 and reduced the blend as well. So it's really not that much that I did. And this gives us this very nice golden sand. Thank you very much for watching, especially if you made it so far. And see you next time.